an interesting talk. Before we begin, please take a moment to silence your cell phones and note our emergency exits. We have one here at the front of the room, and there's another at the back of the room, the doors you came through. The New England Holocaust Memorial, which is located just around the corner from here in the heart of our city, offers a poignant opportunity for reflection on the consequences of bigotry and hatred, for remembering those who lost their lives in the Holocaust, and for honoring the survivors and their legacies. Although it's adjacent to the bustle of Haymarket, Government Center, the North End, and Faneuil Hall Marketplace, the memorial is a place for quiet respect. It is my honor and privilege to welcome and thank our distinguished guests this afternoon. Joining us today are Stephen Ross, the memorial's founder, his son, Boston City Councilor Michael Ross, Robert Treston, the Executive Director of the Anti-Defamation League, and Boston Mayors Ray Flynn and Marty Walsh. Please join me now in welcoming Mayor Walsh to the podium to introduce our speakers this afternoon.
Thank you very much, and I want to thank the FDM for hosting us this morning. I want to thank everyone for being here today. It's a special day for me, and I want to thank Mr. Ross. I met Mr. Ross in room 540 at the State House probably about 17, 18, 19 years ago. He was in the back room with Kevin Fitzgerald, and they were scheming back there about something. I forget what it was, and that was my first introduction to Steve Ross. And from that point to today, the Ross family has been very good friends with me and Mr. Ross in particular for all his great work that you'll hear a lot about today. So I'm already off script here. I want to thank Mayor Flynn, Ambassador Flynn. I call Mayor Flynn and his wife Kathy, who joined us today. Thank you for being with us. Michael was talking to me, and Mary was talking, so I just want to give a few shout-outs to a few people here. I want to thank City Council Josh Jacob, who's with us today. I want to thank the Sheriff Michael Bellotti, who's with us today. Speaker Tommy Turner is with us today. Representative Brian Wallace is with us today. Thank you, Brian. City Council Ed Flynn's with us today. I should have done this now. You could walk the roads and start to do some people, but I want to thank you. I want to thank Robert Treston as well, the Executive Director of the Anti-Defamation League. Thank you for being with us today as well. Glenn Frank as well, and Brian, who worked on this book together. Incredible capturing Mr. Ross's stories. Stories that should be told, need to be told, need to be continually told. So thank you for capturing that in this book today. I'm grateful for your help with Mr. Ross in writing the book. And certainly, as I mentioned earlier, important stories. To go back to Kevin Fitzgerald and meeting Mr. Ross at the State House, and then seeing Brian Wallace and Mr. Ross, and I didn't know they knew each other, and Mr. Ross is being a mentor in the city of Boston, working with young people in the city to help them on a pathway, using his own past in helping people overcome problems that they've had in their lives. That's what this man has done his whole entire life. And I want to thank him. He was a quiet man who lived an incredible life. He was living an incredible life and has done so many things. So I want to thank him for that. He mentored young people from across different neighborhoods, different religions, and different races. And back when Mr. Ross was doing that, we had a very different Boston. It was very different than this today. It was, in some ways, it was very segregated. People didn't leave their neighborhoods. They didn't leave their communities. And I know that what he tried to do was bring kids from Mission Hill over to South Boston, bring kids from Mission Hill into other parts of the city of Boston to really understand, and other people can talk about that a lot better than I can, but it's so important. He cared about what a lot of us have in common, and that's the human good and human decency. His life taught us how to value every single person's humanity. He treated everyone like it mattered, especially you. And as I said, I've been in Mr. Ross's presence an awful lot, and I just watched the way his care and compassion about people are. When I first met him, I certainly knew, and I like to use the phrase, he was the real deal. There was no question about it. You knew where you stood, and you knew exactly what he meant. A humble, genuine man who cares. There was no phony bone in his body, and there's certainly no phony bone in his body today. I remember talking to Mr. Ross about helping me with a situation, and when he told you he could help you, he actually helped you, and he made sure that happened. I want to thank him for that. The New England Holocaust Museum came to the table when Mr. Ross got together, and I know Mayor Flynn will be talking probably in a while about this stuff and how that came about. It's one of the most profound memorials in our city or anywhere in the world. Our annual community Holocaust commemoration is this Sunday at 10:30 a.m., and I certainly like to invite everyone that's coming. And we have, this week in Boston, we have over 275 mayors from around the United States that are coming to Boston to celebrate the United States U.S. Conference of Mayors. And many of the mayors have already RSVP'd. They're going to be joining me on Sunday morning to come and to see what we've done in our city, something special. When it got vandalized last year twice, it was like ripping the fabric of our city. But there was no doubt that our whole community would come together as a whole, and that Mr. Ross was one of the people leading the way to make sure that we continue to move forward. It was an opportunity that we had, a sad one, but an opportunity to teach next generation about what it is and why it's there and why it stands in our city. So in Boston, we will never forget. We will continue to make sure that we never forget. It's also a time in our country right now where we need a wake-up call. We need a wake-up call after Charlottesville, and we still need healing. And we need everything that Mr. Ross represents. He's seen the worst, so he knows what truly matters. His spirit is literally unbreakable. He proves that love is stronger than hate. It's a lesson he blessed our city with. And thanks to this book, we all know for sure, we'll be telling Steve Ross's stories for generations to come. I want to again thank Brian and Glenn for capturing this. I want to thank Michael and Julie for their love of their dad. And I want to thank you all for being here today. And now I think I'm supposed to introduce the ambassador. Is that my job? Okay. And now I have the great honor of introducing somebody who I know Steve Ross as good as, aside from his kids, probably as good as anyone in this room. And that's the former mayor of the city of Boston, the Ambassador Ray Fulton.
Where do you begin? We all admire Steve Ross. But can I just give a little background, because we go way back many, many years. An important event in my life, obviously, as a kid, I wanted to play professional basketball for the Boston Celtics. Ever since I was a ball boy for the Boston Celtics back in 1950. And Red Auerbach was a dear friend of mine. He was almost like a father to me. Well, Red Auerbach got me this right before the opening game, and he cut me from the Boston Celtics. It was a devastating moment, and he said, "Ray, I'm sorry we have to do this, but you know, I have to go with the best we have, and you don't want the best we have." So he says, "Is there anything you can do for me?" So I said, "Well, I'm going back to Boston, I'm getting married, and I don't have a job." So Fred Auerbach picks up the phone and calls the mayor of Boston, who's John Combs, and I had said to him that I would like to work with young kids, to speak to them. Because I started the basketball program, softball programs in South Boston. So the next day I started working for the city of Boston as a street worker. Who do I run into almost the first day? It's Steve Ross, who was also walking the streets of Boston, helping troubled kids, getting kids out of detention facilities, etc. And so we had a special relationship. And those stories built up for years. And I saw the example of Steve Ross on so many occasions of helping young people. It was just absolutely incredible. It really molded this kid from South Boston, Street Corners as well. what kind of politician I would ultimately be. And Steve would go over to Brandeis University, and he would say to the president of Brandeis University, how come no kids from South Boston go to this college? And the next thing you know, there'd be kids from South Boston going to Brian Wallace, and I was standing down with the Boys and Girls Club in South. All these different things over Columbia Point, the Hectos over in that event. That was Steve Ross, and we all learned from that. Well, as years went by, I got into politics. I was a state representative in the city council. And I came up with this idea of inviting kids from the Boston Public Schools, a couple of hundred kids at a clip, to come up to the city council chambers, and we would have a remembrance of the show. And Steve and about four or five other survivors from Auschwitz, like Irving Belson, Dachau, would be there. And there'd be maybe 40, 50 other people from the neighborhoods, Sharon, Mattapan, and Brighton. They would be there. And there'd be 200 kids in the public schools in Boston. Years later, I find out that they'd give this recreation of this special holiday, special holy service, with him and Chief Rabbi would be presiding over the event. Well, as years went by, I would bump into many of these same kids that were at the City Hall chambers of this special event. And they would tell me, you know, Mayor, we didn't even know anything about the Holocaust. We didn't know anything about what had happened. But when you brought us into City Hall, there was a headmaster at South Boston High School who was very instrumental in helping us in, Shelly Winter, love Steve. He was the headmaster at Southview High School. He's criticized during the desegregation period significantly, but a wonderful man. Well, these kids, there'd be 200 kids, and then 200 kids, and 200. We probably reached about 4,000 or 5,000 kids ultimately. And the change, I would watch Steve relate to these kids, and these kids would have an entirely different perspective and outlook on persecution, discrimination, and marginalizing people and treating people with disrespect. And I saw that, and I saw the value of being able to communicate and being able to tell that story, reaching kids from the city. Many of these kids were African American kids and South Boston kids. Well, I know from watching Steve Ross the impact that he had in this city, in the city with young people. You know, so years later, I'm at the mayor's office, and my secretary said to me, Mayor, there's Mr. Ross, Steve Ross, who would like to have an appointment with you. I'm sure it's getting in my way. Steve comes in, and he walks into the mayor's office. I don't know if he had ever been there before, but his eyes were watering, and he gave me this incredible hug. And he started saying, he was kind of fumbling around with it because he didn't want to say it correctly. He said, I want to have an impact on people remembering the tragedy of the Holocaust in Germany, Poland, Europe in the 1940s. Could you help me with that? So I grabbed him by his arm. We walked over to the window, huge window at City Hall, overlooking Faneuil Hall, looking at the statue of Sam Adams, and right up the street was where the birthplace of American freedom, cradle for the Little Faneuil Hall, and James Michael Curley statue. And I said, Steve, this is one of the most, I was chairman of the House Committee at the State House with the statue of Curley. And I said, this is going to be an incredible spot right across the street, the most visible, remarkable spot in the city of Boston, if not America, the birthplace of America. That's where your memorial to the Holocaust, the most tremendous event, and the tragedy of that event. So nobody will ever forget. Nobody will cease to remember what happened during that period of time. My friends, Steve Ross was responsible for the most extraordinary memorial. Yep, we go to Washington, and I know it's down here, Washington, Jefferson, Jack, all these very important places of historical event. But right here in Boston, the cradle of liberty, the birthplace of American freedom, Steve Ross was responsible for having a historic landmark, a historic event placed right here, right up in the most important part of Boston.
Thank you, Ambassador Flynn and Mayor Walsh. I'm Robert Trested. I'm the director of the Anti-Defamation League in Boston. And I'll just take a minute to just say thank you for Mayor Walsh, your incredible leadership throughout your term, but also in particular when the Holocaust Memorial was vandalized twice last year. The first phone call I got was from Commissioner Evans, and your phone call was a few minutes later. And Ambassador Flynn, a long, long partnership throughout your career with the Anti-Defamation League, and really fighting on all across the world, really, on issues around hate and bigotry and anti-Semitism. So, you know, we get to this place today. There are many, many journeys, but we should really acknowledge the leadership that's also in this room, because that leadership makes our lives better, and it's going to make the next generation's lives better, too. So thank you. I do want to, just before we sort of move on, I want to acknowledge and thank Keolis and their parent company, SNCF. So, for those of you who know, if you take the commuter rail, you should be familiar with Keolis, because 2 years ago, when we were starting to just launch this project, and I'm looking at Alan Eisner and also Michael, when we were first working on this, and we started to discuss how we could share Steve's story, get it way beyond this room and people that are reading the book or buying the book online. Keolis was the first partner who came on board, and they were really excited about getting this story into schools. So I just want to thank Alain Larray. He's actually the president of SNCF America. He's in France this week, but joining us today is Clément Michel, who's president and CEO of Keolis North America, David Scorey, who's the general manager of CEO of Keolis Commuter Services in Boston, and Miller. Listen, Keolis gets sometimes a lot of media attention, but we should just take a minute to say thank you to them, because they are the corporate entity really that made a lot of this happen. So thank you. The Holocaust remains a lesson in what can happen when anti-Semitism, extreme hatred, and discrimination goes unchecked, unchallenged, and is allowed to flourish, and when people and institutions and governments refuse to take a stand against injustice. And last year, as everyone in this room knows, the New England Holocaust Memorial that Steve founded was vandalized twice. And that was in a year that brought a 42% increase in anti-Semitic incidents in Massachusetts. And that includes an 86% increase in school-based anti-Semitic incidents in schools where there's kindergarten through grade 12. There has never been a more urgent time to bring the lessons of the Holocaust to the next generation of American leaders. At a time when our country desperately needs it, Steve Ross offers us a rallying cry of how we can overcome the hatred that divides us and divides the world. His story proves the point that one person can make a difference in the lives of the people around them and the cities, states, and countries that they touch. Like the farmer who in 1940 looked at Steve and then turned to his wife and said, "It's okay. Take them inside and give them something to eat." Or the American soldier who on April 29, 1945, climbed down from his tank at the Dachau concentration camp and shared his army rations with Steve. Or Steve, whose persistence and belief in the strength of the human spirit helped thousands of Bostonians get an education, find jobs, and obtain housing. Never, never giving up and never forgetting. Forgetting and giving up were simply not an option, then or now. Rather, teaching, sharing, and believing have always defined who he is as a person. Steve's memoir is an invaluable tool to ignite learning and foster change to make a difference, just as he has done in the lives of many. So today, the Anti-Defamation League is releasing a study guide. It's actually all on your seats. This is a study guide that accompanies his book. And when used alongside his memoir, this guide will allow students to put a human face to history while connecting with what they're learning in their own lives. And it allows students to engage with Steve's story and gain an understanding of the historical facts that contributed to the Holocaust, while also learning the moral and practical decisions that were made by individuals, which impacted whether people literally lived or died. One of the discussion questions, if you take a look in here, one of the discussion questions reminds students that the expression "never again" has been used by survivors since the end of the Holocaust. And it's also used today by groups who want to express their hope that a particular event or tragedy is never repeated. And we ask the students in here, it's a good question for all of us to consider, what does the phrase mean to you? Is it aspirational, or has it become a slogan because genocides and events that denigrate humanity continue to persist? It's a critical question, especially in 2018. I want to share quickly Steve's personal reflections that are in the book related to this phrase. He writes in part, "I know the phrase 'never forget' means that we want future generations of people all over the world to withstand the powers of hate, to stand up to indignities, to not let one group of people be blamed for the wrongs of the world and be subjected to extermination. I know all of that," he writes, "and I want those things too. But sometimes I think to myself, I would do anything to forget." Steve's sheer will to survive and determination to live, along with his willingness to recount his horrific experiences, no matter how painful, has been gifted to all of us. Because in the book, Steve taps into his reader's senses to help us imagine the sights, the sounds, the tastes, the smells that he experienced. Steve, you've made a difference in the lives of thousands. And now, today, it is our turn, it is our responsibility to make a difference by ensuring that just as you vow to never forget, that neither will we. So thank you, Steve, for making a difference in Boston. Thank you for your lasting contribution, the lasting contribution of your memories. And our commitment, our promise, is that the suffering that you endured during and after the Holocaust will fuel and empower the current generation of burgeoning leaders to foster lasting local and global change. That is our responsibility. This is one part of it. The bravery of telling your story, despite how horrifying, ensures that never again will truly mean never. So thank you very much, Steve. discussion. To set the stage for that, I'm going to show a short video clip. Roger Lyons, who is an award-winning filmmaker, where is Roger here? Roger Lyons, with his hand up, is an award-winning filmmaker. Roger has made a documentary, Etched in Glass, which is sort of the movie version of the book. There's three important things here. There's the lesson plan, there's the book, and then there's the film. So we're going to show, just to set the context and a little bit of background before we get into the panel, this is about a two and a half minute clip of the film.
Germany invaded Poland. I was incarcerated in 10 slave labor death camps.
It was relentless for 5 years.
One time I saw the potato. A guard saw me and he gave me 25 lashes with a lead pipe.
Several times I was going to be murdered and I managed to get away.
I can't fathom all this stuff went through.
After I was rescued from hell, I came upon a soldier that showed me compassion, and he gave me a flag.
America brought me here, and they said I'm human.
I didn't have a penny.
I had no place to live, but I lived in the car when I attended Boston University.
But I made something of myself, and you can do the same thing.
Steve was a social worker in the project, only around the time I was just starting to get in trouble.
When I was about 14, I had stolen a car. That was the catalyst that brought Steve Ross into my life.
He made you feel well.
I was just amazed that he was even alive and decided to devote his life to helping kids like us.
And to see somebody actually here, you know, it reaches me, you know?
It is vital to have a memorial, to tell the world of all the atrocities.
In proposing this Holocaust memorial, Steve was the quarterback of the team.
The Six Towers was also the number 6 million. The six-pointed star, the six death camps.
I just want to show you the little flag that was given to me by a soldier.
That's what he gave him. He gave him a flag.
I have searched for this angel for many years.
If this really is my grandfather, he's been searching for 67 years.
Don't give up your education. Stick with it.
And perspectives on Steve's story, and I think we'll probably have some time for some Q&A. Together, Brian Wallace and Glenn Frank worked with Steve to bring his story to the pages of From Broken Glass. Brian served in the House of Representatives from 2003 to 2011. He's also the author of Final Confession, which is on its way to becoming a movie. Brian met Steve when he was in high school in South Boston, when Steve was assigned to his school as a social worker, and Brian credits Steve with inspiring him to stay in school and pursue his dream of becoming a politician in order to one day represent people from his community. And Glenn Frank is a Boston-based attorney and fabulous writer in his own right, having written 3 books with 2 more on the way. He was the winner of the Bruce Rossley Literary Award for Best New Voice in 1999. Mike Ross is going to be the third person on the panel. I think everyone knows Mike's true in connection here is being the son of Steve. Mike is an attorney in Boston, also, as you heard, former Boston City Councilor, president of the City Council, and a good friend, and really the man who has been carrying this project on his shoulders and has the incredible determination to make sure that it gets into the hands of students across hopefully across the country. Moderating is WBUR journalist Max Larkin, a multimedia reporter for Edify, WBUR's education vertical. And since graduating from college in 2011, Max has worked in radio, and podcasting for Open Source with Christopher Lydon, as well as with filmmaker Errol Morris. I'm sure you will recognize his voice as soon as he starts speaking. So have our panelists come up.
By the hand and brought him to my law office
two or three times a week for 3 years so that Steve could tell me his story and I could get it down on paper as best I could in his voice. Probably wasn't all that great for the other clients in the office to see three men weeping uncontrollably understand there, but it was a testament to John Morgan and how hard he worked to get this story to me so that I could begin to work on it. I also, Brian provided a cascade of Boston stories, and the stories would not have been put out without that, and it was absolutely my privilege to try to get those stories into Steve's voice, and I hope it's successful. Steve is one of my favorite people ever, and I am honored and privileged to have worked on it with you, my friend.
Brian, can I just give some context? So you come into the story not as a co-author in late life, but as a young man. And you talked about the figure that Steve Ross cut in your childhood.
Yeah, first I just want to say that it's incredible on quality. What an amazing man. Thank you. Let me lighten it up a little bit. I was 16 years old and hanging out on Ohio Project, which is really one of the toughest places around South. We actually used to get paid for money. Well, you just sit on the stairs so that no one showed up his house. We sat there and took the money. And one day we were just finishing a basketball game, we see this guy walking across the court. And I looked at my friends and I said, he's not a cop, I know that. He's got all clothes and Steve walk and he's walking. And look at him, what is this guy doing? So he comes over to us and he says, Frank Peterson said to me, you asked for the basketball player. Basketball player, he will help you. So he looks at my friend Joe Farrell, he's 6'5". He says, are you the basketball player? He says, he points to me, he says, no, he is. And he says, you! You are the idiot! And my friends, you know, they thought I was going to be mad. I started laughing my head off. I thought, you know, he has no filter, and after what he's been through, he should now. But I said, what can we do for you? He said, I am your new youth worker. One of my friends says, get the hell out of here. You're about 100 years old, screw it. No, I am here to stay. I'm here to get you kids in college. And none of my friends, that year before, South Boston, I had two kids went to college, the whole school, all high school. And he says, no, I won't get you into college. You can't get out of here. And we would have youth workers come down, and they'd last a day. We'd have them getting our cigarettes and taking their car, and they said, see you later. This guy never left. He says, no, I'm here. I'm here to stay. He says, you are going to take the college boards. And so we all looked at each other and laughed, and he said, yeah, right. So he says, no, I'm driving you over to Boston College High School, and you are taking the college boards. And we said, okay. So he drives us over, and we went one door out the back door, and we're home, we're back in Southern California. So the next day, he stops the car in front of me. How are the college boards? I said, they were hot. What a liar! What a liar! You did not take them! And so then he got serious. He said, if you want me to go, I will go. And I said to my friends, you know, this guy cares about us. I said, some of our parents don't even care about us. Our teachers don't care about us. This guy comes down every day and gets us. You know, he cares. And you're right. He does care, and you're right. So we went over the next week, he drove us over. He said, I will drop you. I said, I'm not getting in that shit box, no way. We'll walk over. So we went over to BC High. We all took the college boards, and two of the kids became lawyers, two became doctors, one became the head of the U.S. Marshals, I became a state rep, and just because of him, we wouldn't have done it.
So much of this story is of asking a really young person who is 8 and 9 years old to put up with something that's totally unimaginable, and yet to turn that, convert that experience into a lifetime public service, half a world away, it sort of speaks.
sort of miracle was worth getting on the floor early.
Yeah, the subtitle of the book is My Story of Finding Hope in Hitler's Death Camps to Inspire a New Generation. It makes no sense, but and yet, what he went through, what he went through, a lot of it's in there, not all of it, because you can't put all of it in there because it's too hard. But of what he could put in there, it was the worst you can imagine of what happened to a human being for 5 years. And for him to take out of it hope because of the kindness of basically a single soldier who gave him those rations, and then to use that to bring to other people's lives is really the great story of this book and of Steve Ross. Let me read. I am the one who passed through 10 concentration camps, starved nearly to death, overcame beatings and sexual abuse, poisoning and terror. I am the one who lived somehow. Not my brother and sisters, not my mother and father, not my nieces, my grandmother, my neighbors, or my friends. Some mornings I still joke when I wake and remember what happened, that all of them are gone. What makes the fact of my survival more painful are the reasons that I endured. None, so far as I can gather. I'm simply lucky. I'm not possessed of any extraordinary skills or pain, of pain endurance. I am not stronger than anyone else. I cry and feel agony, just like everyone in the world. People have challenged me throughout my life about my sense of luck. You're the most unlucky person I know, I've been told. True, I was orphaned by the Holocaust, broken, and made witness to, and in a few cases that I wish I could forget, made the target of cruelties beyond the imagination. But the people who don't recognize my luck can't see what I see, that I am here, and 6 million others who endured everything I did had to also give up the biggest thing of all, their lives. That sense of hopefulness in the face of hardship, combined with the lessons I learned from fellow death camp prisoners about moral courage and human tenderness, is something I tried always to bring to my 40-year career as a public youth counselor working in some of Boston's poorest neighborhoods. To all the students who listen, I would tell my story and show that if I can survive what I did, they can face their own struggles, come to grips with the injustices they are up against, and fight to overcome them, maybe even to prosper.
It's an amazing story, and yet, as Robert said earlier, there is this ambivalence where Steve admits to, and sometimes wanting to forget some of these painful, traumatic memories. I wonder, in the book process, at that point, Steve was sharing the story, he was the founder of this memorial, but what did you see as your responsibility in bringing this book to light and me hearing it's going to be in classrooms? What can we learn from this incredible life experience?
Well, I know what I learned from this incredible life experience, which was in sitting with Steve, I was able to really get to the most gritty parts of the horrible things that happened to him, and some are almost unspeakable. But even in sitting with him, his absolute sense of utter optimism in the face of all that actually is inspiring. So if you are a person that knows Steve, or if you're a person that has sat with Steve and tried to tell his story, or if you're a person that lived his story, you are absolutely, you have no chance, no choice, except to be optimistic, because that it exudes from him. And that's the only thing you can take from your story, in spite of the fact, and I don't know who's read this and hasn't, the stories that he had to endure are actually literally unspeakable. Lost his parents, the abuse and everything, it's just absolutely unspeakable, but here he is, an optimistic man who's given everyone who's coming to him.
One thing I think it would do well to discuss is, you know, we are living in a time where all these things feel a sort of certain new freshness. Of course, the memorial being vandalized, we have children being separated from their parents at the border. This is maybe the beginning of a painful story being told in this book. We had in the book busing and the moment at which black students were being pelted as they were being carried following in order to desegregate and equalize our schools. All of these things are echoes, even if they're not as extreme and extraordinary as the violence that Steve experienced as a young man. I wonder, does that speak to you, Michael? Does it speak to you as co-authors that we're not as far from this as we would like to be?
Maybe I'll just quickly, when this book came out, I was reading an article about the Yazidi women who were being targeted and raped by ISIS and how they've been trying to rebuild their lives in different countries now. And I mean, you know, the first time I thought about maybe someone experiencing, from what I read in those accounts, something close to, you know, what my father went through. And I feel like if he could pull his life together and do what he did, I feel like it's an inspiring story for anyone who's struggling. Maybe it's something that you need to read later in life when you've had a chance to pull yourself up. But it's very relevant to today. Robert's organization, the ADL, he didn't mention, I don't think, or missed the mayor, I was talking to the mayor, that the rate of anti-Semitic incidents is up by the hundreds in the last 2 years, percentage points. Not incidents, but percentage points in this country. Attacks on Jewish sites and other people and ethnicities and minorities. So this book right now is extremely timely for those reasons.
One of the things Steve did was when he came to this country, he went to BU, has a degree in psychology, and then he went looking for a job. First job he got was a truant officer. And so he saw, again, this guy, obviously wasn't from this country, and he said, I got this thing, I'd like to apply for this job. And they said, okay, you got it. But we're going to send you to Coney Point. Now, Steve does go to Coney Point from City Point, you know, and he said, I'll send me anywhere, I'll go anywhere. So Coney Point is the area in the city of Boston where nobody lasts more than 3 days, no truant officer. Youth worker lasted more than 3 days. Steve lasted 2 years. He went down there and he changed the culture. He changed the culture of Columbia Point, where everyone thought that Columbia Point was gone. You know, it's not even worth going there. He was down and changed it. He goes to, takes the school attendance report and says, where are all these students? And the principal says, I don't know where they are, they're not here. So he goes and knocks on the doors. And the people look at him like, are you crazy? This is Columbia Point, Jimmy, you don't do that. And he did it. And within a year, they had turned that around. They had gone from last in attendance to third in the city. And that was him. That was just one man who decided that, no, enough is enough. These kids have to go to school. And that's his whole mantra, is education, education, education. You heard from Frank Berger, education, education, education. And we had heard enough of that by the time we left us. But it's been a great honor. And I just would be remiss if I didn't recognize my agent, our agent, Mike Williams here. Mike is the guy who got the book to New York and made it happen. And our editor from New York, David Lamb, is here as well. So thank you guys for your help. And obviously, we wouldn't be here without you.
Like, how did that education theme play out in your own home? Was there anxiety about senior years or being too?
Julie has a law degree, and I have a law degree and an MBA, and Joe's the third generation. Joe, stand up and do a big wave. This is my dad's grandson.
Was partially put to an end by American soldiers. What should we feel in 2018 when we walk under those glass towers? Is it simply never again, or are we thrown back on our conscience a little bit as we see some of these developments in our country?
Filibuster here. My dad would be telling you, and that's why I'm up here, is that he built the memorial for his family. He needed a place and for the other survivors' families and the next generation. Are there second generations in this room? These people don't have a place to go remember their family. They needed a place because there are no cemeteries. There's no cemeteries for most of the survivors, most of the victims of the Holocaust. And so the families of survivors, the families of victims, needed a place to go. That is initially what his drive was. He needed a place to remember. It only became this broader theme about the values of our community as it went up. When the memorial was shattered twice last year, it was non-Jewish people who stood up and apprehended the people who threw the rocks on both occasions. A taxi driver, a person leaving a restaurant late at night. They felt that their values were being attacked. Their values, not Jewish values, not Holocaust survivors or victims' values, but the values of our city, of our community. And that's what this thing has become to our city. When you come to Boston and you see those towers, you know that you're in a place that has those values.
Steve said to me that Ray Flynn is the number one Irish Jew in the city.
Pitching in to accomplish stated goals. There's one of them is to take care of war orphans from the First World War. Very poignant poster. And I feel that call when I finish the book. I feel called to do something anew. I'm a reporter. But Michael, did you take any of that sort of public service ethos into your work as a politician, as a elected official, and what would you tell your son or your Steve's grandson to bring into the world?
You know, I think the best gift that Dad gave to Julie and I, and to Joseph now, but also to all of us, is this gift of perspective. You know, Julie and I grew up, we didn't complain. You ate the food on your plate. You didn't leave food on your plate. And that's a thing that every kid gets in their family, but all the more when you have a Holocaust survivor as a parent. We were given the gift of perspective, to value what we have, to feel rich even if you were poor. That's the gift that he gave to all those kids. That's the gift he gave you, Brian. He said to us, if you watch that documentary that Robert did, which is amazing, he has a kid talking, he talks to a kid in there, and he says, "The United States didn't give me anything. They didn't hand me money. They didn't hand me food. But they said I was a person, an individual, a human being. And that was enough for me for that part of my life." And that's what he needed. And, you know, he's given that. In some ways, he's been able to share that with us, to be grateful for what we have.
I'm going to make this a little bit more personal. The legacy of the Holocaust Memorial is obviously striking and very meaningful. But another legacy that Steve put on this world is Mike and Julie and the incredible family that he's got. This taking these children and, you know, let them go out into the world and the success and the message that is going to resonate from that for a very long time.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you. I just want to say, I don't know how this came about, but thanks to Roger Lyons, the Connecticut legislature this term passed a bill to make the Holocaust Memorial mandatory in every high school study of the Holocaust. So I'm filing a bill with Lou Kafka, a rep from Sharon, next term. So, hey, I'm going to be the number one Irish Jew from now.
Max, I know you're opening up to questions, but I would be remiss if I didn't say, my dad didn't do it alone. I have a very spectacular person in the audience here tonight, and that is my mother, Suzanne London, who's right up there. Ma, just a quick stand.
Is it time for questions? I don't know. Let's go to the Q&A. Do we have anybody who want to volunteer? Somebody's going to break the ice. Someone has to be the first one.
So, you're reading the book, which I just finished a couple of days ago, which of course is riveting. I noticed that you didn't tell the Holocaust story straight through and then go to the present. You kind of jumped around. What was the thinking on doing that?
Just for anybody who had a trouble hearing, the story is told out of sequence, so Boston Holocaust memoir, Boston memoir, and why did the writers take that approach?
Where is David Lamb? Where is he? So, he has to take full responsibility for that. It was obviously a discussion amongst the three of us, but it was David's idea to sort of intersperse that to make sure that the story had forward motion, and obviously that it portrayed the theme that we were doing, which is hopefulness and optimism. So David, that was David's structure. So.
Stand up. And you need breaks. Even in the film, Roger puts breaks. It's too hard to read through. I see Kim, my future mother-in-law, is in the front, shaking her head. She needed those breaks because it's just too hard to read through.
Anyone else? Another question or comment?
So, I'm just wondering about the process of aging the voice when you have a memoir that begins at 8 years old.
So, I sat with Steve for many sessions and worked very hard to try to get his first-person voice correct. And it was particularly challenging to try to get his 8-year-old voice and try to bring that along as the story was going forward. But I tried to think of the things that my grandchildren would say, who are approximately the age Steve was when he was orphaned, and try to use that intonation going forward to put it together with Steve's voice and try to make sure that it was consistent in aging all the way along. I hope I was successful at that, and it's more impressive to see it in me, but it was a labor of love.
I think also having Brian be an eyewitness to that voice, it was helpful to get some stories as well into the modern,
yeah,
the later years.
Yeah, I think when we started the whole process, a number of people said, what happened in the Holocaust was horrendous, and Glenn did capture it. I tip my hat to him, he did. But that's only half the story. And I think it was David Lamb who said, the story needs an eye. It needs, a beginning, middle, and an end. And the end basically was what he did when he came to Boston. It wasn't just a Holocaust story, it was a story about this guy who just changed so many lives. And that's what he did every day when he woke up. And it was money, he just did it because it was the right thing to do. And he helped more people than any politician I know, including myself, and he just did it every day. And more people went to college in Southie because of him, and they became doctors and lawyers because of him. And that had to be told. That was part of the story I had to be told.
Why do you think education mattered so much to your dad, your co-writer? Why education? I'm an education reporter, so I'm bringing a little professional bias in.
His mom said to him once that you'll be a great man. He said, you will be a great man. And my dad dad interpreted that as being an educated man. And he believed in education, he could hold on to it. And he truly would. Brian said, get the education, get the education. It was his mantra. It was family. It was why we went to school and attacked the books like we did. He always told us, you have to read, you have to do it. And then I tell my nephew and I tell others, I do the same thing. It sounds just like he truly believed in it. And it's true. In this country, if you have nothing, if you study, if you work hard, and it's getting harder for that, much harder. But certainly when my dad got there, you could do it. And he can still do it. It just takes a lot of work.
Mike, and I think that when Steve came over to this country, to Boston anyway, one of his roommates was a guy named Berta. And this guy, that's all he thought about. He kept saying to Steve, it's about education, education, education. And this guy applied to Harvard 3 times, walked over himself, finally they said, okay, we'll let you in. And he gave me the world-renowned art specialist. Yeah, he was a survivor. But he told Steve that you don't get anywhere in this world without education. And that's what Steve brought to us. You know, he kids can hang on the project the rest of their life, drinking beer and smoking cigarettes. He says, but what good is that going to do? Why don't you become a doctor? He said to me, you're never going to play for the Salvation Army. He said, why don't you own the Celtics? I said, how do you think I own the Celtics? Education. Education. But that was it. That was it all the time.
I think having been privileged to know Steve for a number of years, one thing that strikes me about him is really, a lot before the motivational speakers, the Tony Robbins of the world were there, there was Steve Ross. And it's his incredible positive thinking and optimism that carried him both through the Holocaust and the post-Holocaust era. Now, obviously, luck has a lot to play with in terms of who survived and who didn't survive in the Holocaust, but I think that, and also his incredible desire, his perseverance to live, and his idea of seeing a better tomorrow, a hope for tomorrow, a better world for himself, that propelled him out of the Holocaust and propelled him to the role that he had over the years as a counselor to the youth in Boston, and many of whom who are here today, he's helped and continued to help. A quick example, prior to a young man, a youth who came from a troubled background, was on his way to Afghanistan. He was a Marine, and he was disturbed about that. And he opened up I brought him to see Steve, and I showed him everything that Steve had gone through, all the memorabilia on his wall. And this very stoic Marine was brought to tears because Steve had filled him with so much positive reinforcement, so much hope, and so much of a sense of purpose in what he was doing. And he said that carried him a lot through Afghanistan, through the trials and tribulations. And he wants to see you. He's come back. One piece, he's very optimistic and would love to get reunited. But the point is, it's really the incredible power of positive thinking as exhibited by Steve. And to this day, he still smiles when he sees people that he knows or wants to know or should know.
You know, one thing I'll never forget when he came down the first day, half the kids I was hanging with at the time were going to Vietnam. You know, and we thought that's what you had to do. You know, our fathers went to World War II and brothers went to Vietnam, and that was our only out, we thought, you know, hanging on the cross for the rest of your life, until he came. And then he said, you know, to Brandeis, it's a great story. You know, it's Brandeis in the Milwaukee Missions Council, and he said, how many boys do you have, boys and girls do you have in here from the city of Boston next semester? And the dean said, I don't know, I'll have to check. He said, don't check. And he said, how do you know? He said, I checked. He said, do you think these boys and girls who are now from New York to go to Brandeis would get a better education if they were with boys from Boston? And the guy said, whoa, you know, whereabouts in South Boston? Whoa. He said, I don't know, he said, I have 6 people, I will bring them to you. And those 6 people went to Brandeis. And like I said, 2 doctors, 2 lawyers, and 1 social worker. So those guys are going to be in other than this guy. So. It's amazing. I mean, I honestly could go on for hours about the people that he saved. But I'll write another book. Maybe one more book.
So the other thing, we talked about optimism before, and that certainly is one of the primary characteristics. But perseverance is also one of the traits that I'm absolutely positive got him through the ordeal that he did, and then got him to pursue his education. He ended up with a PhD in psychology. Master's in certificate of advanced Scottish same thing.
He's honorary degree, but not many.
Yeah, many, many degrees. He persevered through university, I think living in his car for some of it too. So, I mean, the guy has, in addition to tremendous perseverance, and I think that takes you a long way in life.
Back here?
Last question.
Okay, I would like to say thank you to Steve for being an example for all of us, to Steve for sharing the story. Mike, I was moved when you just said that your dad didn't start talking about his story when he was about your age. So that he started talking about his experience, and that you all helped him turn it into a book, and that this book and the ADL's brochure pamphlet is more than a pamphlet, workbook, is going to be used as a tool for education to continue to touch lives and change lives and open minds. I mean, as a lifelong teacher, thank you for that. It's just really, the whole thing is inspirational and overwhelming. So thanks.
Okay, bye, book.
Legislature that are out there, I think they're all waiting for the book signing ceremony. That, I understand we're going to do.
We're headed out there. Yeah, the books are for sale. In fact, it really is a remarkable narrative. Just what someone can live through and then go and give back to their new community. Real American story. It's amazing to have you all here.
Thank you.
Thank you.